Alexander Pope wrote in his epitaph for Sir Isaac Newton, "Nature and nature's laws lay hid in night, God said. Let Newton be, and all was made light." To which J.C. Squire, in his epigrams, replied, "It did not last. The devil howling, 'Ho, let Einstein be,' restored the status quo." The famous sci-fi author Douglas Adams hilariously parodied quantum metaphysics with the infinite improbability drive in The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Great book. When mathematicians dismiss the physics principles of every effect must have a preceding cause and no creation ex nihilo, it's no wonder that modern physics and cosmology read like science fiction. I think Nikola Tesla said it even better, though, and I quote, "Today's scientists substitute mathematics for experiments, and they wander off through equation after equation, and eventually build a structure which has no relation to reality." End quote. I know it's a shocker, but it turns out scientists can only really advance science when the physical concepts they are sciencing on are real. Here's why the theory of everything may be out of reach for these guys, and even in the case of the EU model of cosmology, can only really rise to a strong hypothesis. If we actually deal in the real universe we can detect with our senses, augmented by modern technology, uncovering the fabric of reality doesn't seem so far-fetched. This theory would explain only what we can see and detect, the things that we know are present. And naturally, some things out at the extremes are either too big or too small for us to ever grok, not to mention everything in between that we overlook because we didn't know it was important. And neither Einstein's relativity or quantum mechanics are really physics, so we can't use them as a foundation for our new model, although we should find that the mathematics that work in the real world still apply. Time to toss a lot of the modern physics and return to the classical physics of a century ago. The natural philosopher. But the largest hurdle is ourselves. Having the courage to discard your training and prejudices and be willing to approach the subject from a beginner's mind is not a small task, even harder for those who pride themselves as intellectual. That something absolutely fundamental that the standard model experts are always missing in all these explanations of gravity and quantum behavior is, of course, the electric force. The electric structure of matter. We're not talking about negative electrons and positive atomic nuclei. It's deeper than that. Down in the murky depths, all subatomic particles, including the electron, are resonant structures of electric charge of opposite sign that sum to the charge on that particle. The electron isn't a fundamental point-like particle. It must have structure to provide its dipole magnetic field. There must be orbital motion of charges within the electron to generate the magnetic dipole. The transfer of electrical energy between the charges in their orbits must be resonant and near instantaneous for the electron to be a stable particle. The same model applies to the proton and the neutron. This model satisfies Einstein's view that there must be some lower level of structure in matter to cause resonant quantum effects. And that's just the beginning. We can't have a theory of everything until we have a workable concept of the structure of matter that satisfies the observation that inertial and gravitational mass are equivalent. When we accelerate electrons or protons in an electromagnetic field, the faster they go, the less responsive to the fields they become. This has been interpreted as an increase in mass, but charges don't have mass. So how exactly are they supposed to give the electron, proton, and neutron the property of mass? That doesn't make much sense. The accelerating electromagnetic field will distort the orbits of charges within the electron or proton. Now it seems the more distorted a particle becomes, the more easily the energy supplied to accelerate the particle is assimilated in further distortion rather than acceleration. Hence the apparent increase in mass. The more you put in, the more they distort instead of speeding up. The inertial mass of a particle is a measure of the degree to which it responds to an electric field by distorting rather than accelerating. It implies that the charge centers of a proton at rest have to be separated more than those of an electron at rest, and that allows the proton to distort more readily than an electron in the same electric field, and accounts for the differences in the size and mass. Quote, "What we call mass would seem to be nothing but an appearance. and all inertia to be an electromagnetic origin. End quote. Henry Poincare, Science and Method. A neutron combines the charges from a proton and an electron in a barely stable resonance, which decays in minutes. Its decay must have a cause and may involve the interaction with a neutrino. However, when combined with protons, it seems neutrons form a new stable resonance structure that serves to bind the protons electrically, despite the overall positive charge on the nucleus. This idea that normal matter can be annihilated when it touches antimatter is a confusion of language. Matter can neither be destroyed or created, we know that. It can't be exchanged for energy either. Einstein's E equals mc squared refers to mass, not matter. Mass is a property of matter, not matter itself. The mathematical relationship represents the restructuring of resonant systems of charge. What seems to happen in annihilation is that the complementary resonant charge structures of a particle and its antiparticle combine, so that almost all the internal energy is radiated away and the combined charges form a new collapsed particle of low internal energy, a neutrino. The most collapsed form of matter we know of. And unlike the so-called super-condensed matter hypothesis the standard model relies on, it's actually real. It's got a teeny tiny mass, but that said, the neutrino must contain all the charges required to form two particles, a particle and its antiparticle. Empty space is full of neutrinos. And this is what Wall Thornhill considered the ether to be. These things are the repositories of matter in the universe. They lay there waiting for a burst of gamma radiation to expand them into the stuff of atoms. The weird zoo of short-lived particles created in a particle accelerator and seen in cosmic rays are simply unstable resonant systems of charge. The equivalence of inertial and gravitational mass implies that gravity is also an electrical force. And before Einstein, some noted scientists were suggesting that the gravitational force between neutral particles might ultimately be due to electrical polarization within the particles. In 1882, Frederick Zollner wrote in the introduction to his book, Explanation of Universal Gravitation Through the Static Action of Electricity and the General Importance of Weber's Laws, and I quote, "We are to conclude that a pair of electrical particles of opposite signs, i.e. two Weberian molecular pairs, attract each other. This attraction is gravity. It is proportional to the number of molecular pairs." End quote. It's true, gravity can be presented as the sum of the radially aligned electric dipoles formed by all subatomic particles within a charged planet or star. This new electrical concept suggests that Newton's universal constant of gravitation, or G, is a dependent variable. G depends on the charge distribution within a celestial body. Highly charged objects, like comets, look like solid rock, yet they have a gravitational field that suggests they are fluffy snowballs. Now they really are solid rock. Looks like our eyes weren't lying to us. As they discharge, they suffer what's sometimes called non-gravitational accelerations. The extreme weakness of the force of gravity compared to the electric force is a measure of the minuscule electric dipolar distortion of nucleons. Gravity cannot be shielded by normal electrostatic shielding because all subatomic particles within the gravitational field respond to the dipolar distortion, whether they're metals or nonmetals. But what about magnetism? Ampere's law for the magnetic force between two current-carrying wires is found to be equivalent to the transverse electric force caused by the distortion of electrons in an electric field. Now, this distortion causes them to form tiny collinear electric dipoles. That is, the magnetic force is simply another manifestation of the electric force. Kind of looks like a pattern to me. Now, the simple electric model of matter has the great virtue of reducing all known forces to a single one, the electric force. However, it's got a price. First, it means we need to drop this idea that nothing goes faster than light. But I don't mind. That idea is weird anyway. Oh, light's fast, but when you're talking about cosmic distances, light speed is obviously not enough. An arbitrary speed cap like that makes no sense in a model that requires force to be transmitted by particles. If an electron is made of smaller subunits of charge orbiting within its classical radius, then obviously the electric force must be operating at speeds way faster than light in order for it to remain coherent. In fact, it's been calculated that if released, the subunits of charge in the electron could travel from here to the far side of the Andromeda galaxy within 1 second. I guess they didn't get the speed limit memo from Big Space. We have direct evidence of faster-than-light action of the electric force. Gravity is a longitudinal electric force. In fact, Newton's celebrated equation requires that gravity act instantaneously on the scale of the solar system. It's been calculated that gravity must operate at a speed of at least 20 billion times the speed of light. Something like ludicrous speed, I guess. So now we have a candidate for the solar medium, the backdrop that underpins everything we see and can explain everything that exists. But does this hypothesis rise to the level of a theory of everything? Well, join me in episode 3, where we finish making the case for our electrified model, and then I'll wrap up the series by detailing the reasons why our hypothesis narrowly misses that mark. I'll see you there.